Okay, I think I will slowly start because I will repeat for something like 5 to 10 minutes. I'm trying to convince you that what I'm talking to you about is something rather, if not easy, but definitely at least on the level on which I explain you, it is not complicated. And then the details, they're in papers which you can find from the references. So, I am talking about nonlinear partial differential equations, which I write in the form 1. Quite millions, literally millions of realistic, or maybe thousands. Realistic partial differential equations can be written in this form. So time derivatives plus linear part of equation plus nonlinearity, equals to the right-hand side. Right-hand side, it's eta of t, and this is eta omega of t, there is initial condition. And I recall that this equation appears in the following way. I have a nonlinear partial differential equation for the function u of tx. I regard it as a curve in certain functional space. And then I rewrite my partial differential equation as an ordinary equation in this functional space H, right? Then noise here, this is very closely related to the affine control which Professor Agrashov spoke about, because the noise is the following. You remember that in the space H I have the basis phi j, which is made out of eigenfunctions of the operator L. L of phi j equals to lambda j phi j, and lambda j is at least 1, and lambda j goes to infinity. Lambda j, this is always like this. Then my noise is like this. So this is precisely what Professor Agrashov called affine noise or affine control. Because watch, my noise is the following. Eta of t equals to some fixed vector fields. For me, vector field is just constant vector field, phi j, element of basis, and just multiply something which you can call either control or just random force, and for me it is random force. Bj, what is my notation? Eta j, right? I can regard this eta j of t, I can regard it as a control, and then this is what Professor Agrashov spoke about, right? Because you see, you should clearly understand that phi j, I can regard it as a vector field in the space Aj, as a constant vector field, right? So this is vector field phi j, right? So this is precisely what Professor Agrashov called affine control. Then I told you that first summation goes from 1 to m. M may be either finite or infinite. Then I said hm, this is linear envelope of this elements of basis which are involved here. Phi j from 1 to m. Yes? So the noise sits in the space hm. But I study the equation in the whole space H. So, and this is how they interact. This is equation. I make one assumption which is innocent. No physicist will ever, at least for the level. You see, in 20 or 30 years, well, all this will be heavily developed. This assumption that all eta j's, they independent, identically distributed, they people may relax it. But now, for the moment, this is absolutely perfect. So different random processes, which stands here for different j's, they are independent, identically distributed. It means the following. I take one fixed process, eta 1 omega of t, it's a random process, and I make independent copy of it. And these are processes eta 2, eta 3, and then eta 4. Therefore, to describe properties of these processes, I can describe only properties of the process eta 1, because all other processes, they are the same. they are the same. Important quantity for me is quantity B, which is summation of bj squared, which is finite. Which is finite quantity. So it means that I am spoken about. Okay, well, just we will see a bit later what does it mean. What does it mean? So then, apart from this rather innocent restriction, I impose another restriction which is much less innocent. Much less innocent, but which is not physically absurd either. So physicists do not really object, but it would be better to remove it. So this is the following. I defined segments jeta L, which is a segment from L minus one to L. I consider restrictions of the process jeta one on the segments, where L equals to 1, 0, 1, 2, etc. Shift in time. I can regard these processes as processes on the segment number one, yes, 0, 1, right? Shift in time, I think I regard all these processes as defined for T from 0 to 1. And then I make another assumption that all these processes, jeta 1 when L is 1, 2, etc., that all these processes also are independent, identically distributed. Right? So these coefficients are all independent, identically distributed, and which is much more serious and which would be very good to replace this assumption by something more physical. Also restriction of these processes on these time intervals also, which appear in the talks of Professor Grashov, they are also independent, identically distributed. Fortunately, there are nice examples of the process like this, which are quite satisfactory from the physical point of view. Eta 1, yes, thank you, right, Eta 1, yes, Eta 1. Now next, I started to talk about some probabilistic terminology, which will be very important. First, I told you that Polish spaces, these are metric spaces, so spaces with distance, right, which are also complete and which are separable. They are extremely important for the all of theory of probability. They will be important for my talks, and there are plenty of them around. Every separable Hilbert space is a Polish space, and blah, 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 right? Also, every Polish space is provided with sigma algebra of Borelian sets, which is the most common sigma algebra ever used. And I worked with the space of measures on the space of M. I told you that if we remove trivial case when the space M is either finite or countable, so if you treat this, if you consider only really infinite Polish spaces M, that all the spaces of measures are isomorphic. In this theory, canonical example of Polish space is the segment 0, 1. Right? So from the point of view of measure theory, all spaces of measures are the same as spaces of measures on a segment 0, 1. This is deep, serious, highly non-trivial result. Actually, I will not use it, but it is just good to know this. Also, what I told, that of course, since it is stochastic setting, then we have somewhere here on the corner, we have probability space on which my random variable depends. Probability space omega fp. Omega is the space, f is the sigma algebra, and p is the probability, right? Then random variable is any measurable map from the space omega to a correspondent Polish space M, which is given Borel sigma algebra. It is measurable. It means that pre-image of every measurable space belongs to this sigma algebra. Then I told that extremely important is the notion of the law of a random variable Xi. The law of a random variable Xi, this is a measure on the space M, on the space M, which is defined by the following relation. This is such a measure, so that the measure evaluated for any set Q equals to probability that the random variable Xi belongs to Q. Random variable Xi belongs to Q. This gives me a relation that for every random variable corresponds a measure. This mapping, this correspondence is a surjective. This is a very well-known fact, so that if you have any probability measure on the space M, you can find a good random variable such that the law of this random variable is this measure. And due to what I said above, when you do this, you always take for omega sigma 0, 1. Sigma 1, right? Actually, for all of theory of probability space, which is sigma 0, 1, is sufficient. It's sufficient. No other space are needed, okay? Right. So now, why distributions of random variables are so important? This is because of the following formula, which is okay. How to look? Let us take a bounded measurable function defined on this on a Polish space M. We have a distribution of some random variable which is a measure. I have a function, I have a measure. I can integrate function against this measure. How to do this? How to do this? This is trivial but extremely important relation. I will give it to the name A. I will refer it from time to time. Relation is obvious, but in some context, it will be not so easy to see that what I'm talking about. So what is this relation? Look. So if I take any function, measurable function on the space M, if I integrate it against a measure, which is a law of a random variable Xi, right? So this is simply, I have to do the following. I have to take composition F of Xi, and I have to take expected value of this object, right? Since this is what physicists are concerned with, as I said, as soon as physicists consider any model which depends on random parameter, any equation which depends on random parameter, any function which depends on random parameter, then immediately they have this tendency that instead of considering function like energy, like moment, they immediately have tendency study the expected values, right? So, but and this is for us, this is rules. So you see, what they look at, this is obtained as an integral against this measure, right? And just tautological remark that this is nothing but integral over the space of omega, integral of what? I take f of Xi of omega pd omega, right? Pd omega. So this is why the distribution of random variables are so important. Another construction which is very closely related and which I will use always. You see, this is what I'm talking to you so far, which I call probability theory, is not probability, it's just measure theory. You can find it in many courses in functional analysis. In the section spaces of measures. This is not probability theory yet. Probability theory, good definition is that probability theory starts when we start to consider independent random variables, right? So, but this is functional analysis. One more important construction, which will be important for me, is the following. Like M and N be two Polish spaces. Let F be a measurable mapping from Polish space M to the space N, right? It means that pre-image of every Borel set here is the Borel set here. Let us take a measure mu here in the domain of definition. So this is a measure in the space M, right? Then given a map F and given a measure mu here, I can construct an image, push forward, of the measure mu under the map F. So push forward of the measure mu under the mapping F. This is a measure. This is a measure on the space N. And it is defined by the following relation. It is a measure such that being evaluated for any set Q, this is simply measure mu of the pre-image. Of the pre-image, f minus one if f minus one and q. If we consider this with this definition, right? If we consider this definition with this definition, right, then we will simply see, we will immediately see that if I have a random variable like this, that the law of random variable xi is nothing but push forward of measure p, which is this measure, under the mapping psi, right? If I have a measurable mapping, that sigma algebras, then sets move from right from one to left, we consider pre-images, and measures move from left to right, right? So pre-image of Borelian set is Borelian set here. For any measure here, I can construct image of this measure under the set F. It is very dangerous to violate this rule, because even if F is smooth map from real line to real line, right? If you consider here perfect Borelian set, for example, open interval, it is not true that image of this of open interval is measurable set in the right hand side. Okay, so measurable sets under any map F, they move from right to left. Measures move from left to right. If we violate this rule, we should be very, very careful. Right, so this is interesting part of mathematics, which was intensively developed in Russia and France 100 years ago. And just notation. Notation is the following. Look, let I have a measure mu in some Polish space M, and let I have a bounded continuous function on the space M. This is a notation of the space of bounded continuous function, right? Then I will denote integral. Then I can integrate function against measure. I can integrate function f against measure mu. This is notation. Sometimes I'll write it as like this, right? And this is just integral. This is f of u mu of du. Okay. So this is just notation. Right. Now let us go back to equation, and let us slowly move in the process of study of long time behavior of solution for this equation, keeping in mind these objects which I mentioned to you above. Look, what I'm going to do. I'm going precise as in the lecture of Professor Grachev. I'm going to cut time x to segments of length one, right? And I will construct my solution step by step, first on this segment, second on this segment, thirdly on this segment, blah 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 blah, right? And I will try to understand what happens, right? And let me recall you, right, that when I restrict the random process, which is the right-hand side of my equation, to, for example, to this segment, which is segment number two, still I make shift of variable, so I regard it as a function of t, where t varies from zero to one. Another symmetric notation. So you see, eta j, where j is lower index, this is component number j of the process eta. Maybe it is a bit misleading, but hopefully not, that eta one, this is a process eta restricted to the sigma j1. So yes. So process eta, when t varies here, this is eta one. This is eta one. And now watch. For every omega, for every omega, eta 1 of omega. This is a function of t, where 0 smaller than t smaller than 1, right? Therefore, it is very natural to consider to define space E. This is my permanent notation. I will use it always. Not so many. So E is L2 space on the segment 0, 1, valued in the space Hm, which is either finite or infinite notation, right? And then watch. For every omega, J1 of omega is an element of the space, right? For every omega, J1 of omega is a curve from 0 to 1. They will be bounded, so this is L2, it belongs to the space always. Therefore, eta 1, this is a random variable which sends omega to the space E, right? So this is random process when time varies from 0 to 1. This is the same as to say that it's a mapping from omega to E, right? Okay, so this is extremely important, another extremely important notation. Since this is a random variable, I can consider a law of this random variable, right? And I will denote it L, and this is the object which I will work with always. So this is a measure in this space E. And E, let me keep it here. E is L2 space on the segment 0, 1, valued in the space Hm, right? So these are objects. Now, good and interesting question. Now I will start to put restrictions on the measure and just on the distribution. I imposed already some restrictions on my process. Restrictions were like this. P1. That the different components are independent, identically distributed. Restriction P2, that if I take process eta 1, I restrict it to J1. I take same process, is restricted to J2. They are also independent, identically distributed. Restriction P3. P3, this is some non-degeneracy assumption which will appear later. So non-degeneracy. And now one more restriction. So look, so what is this one more restriction? Did I put it? Eta J, maybe, okay. Let me put it. I think I told this already. This will be restriction. Maybe P0. Maybe P0. So as the title of my lectures said, I will consider equations where the noise is bounded random process. That is, if I take noise eta omega of t, then the force which I have in the right-hand side, the norms of the forces which I have in the right-hand side of my equation, they are bounded by some uniform constant c. This happens for all omega, for all t. Right. Now watch. I denote d of eta 1, measure the distribution of the process eta restricted to the segment 0, 1. This is a measure in the L2 space of the segment 0, 1, right? Due to my assumption number 0, this is measure supported by some set of bounded functions. I need condition number P4. That if I denote by k support of this measure, so this is minimal closed set such that L of this closed set equals to 1, right? Support of this measure. Then my restriction is that this is a compact subset of the space E. So one more notation. So you see eta 1, this is a process eta restricted to the sigma G1, and naturally eta R is the process eta restricted to the sigma GR. Not so many notations, I think it is we can get used to them. Now some very important point. So look, process eta. I naturally restricted to the sigma 0, 1, because on the sigma 1, 2, it will be the same, on the sigma 2, 3, also the same, right? I restricted this on this sigma, and I consider this as a random variable in the space L2, right? But I told you many times, number of times, that in fact, this is a bounded random variable. So for any omega, this is L2 curve, such that for every omega and every t, this norm of this L2 curve is bounded by some constant. So it means that in fact I'm talking about subspace of bounded, but bounded curves lives in the space L infinity, right? And I insist that I want to consider the law of this force in the space L2. But it sits in the much smaller space L infinity. Question. Why I do not want to define L as the law of the random force in the space L infinity? Guesses why? Why I avoid space L infinity despite I know that my forces are bounded? Because it is not Polish. Space L infinity is not separable. If I try to use properties of the space of measures in the space L infinity, I will find myself in very, very serious trouble. Therefore, what we are forced to do, we consider the law of this process in the measure of the space L2, but we always remember that in fact that it is supported by the space of bounded functions. This is the best solution. So because for the theory of probability, it is very dangerous to leave this comfortable realm of Polish spaces. As soon as we start to talk about spaces which are not Polish, we are in danger. We're in danger. Thank you. Yes. Yes. No. This is just abstract equation. For me, if we keep in mind complex Ginzburg-Landau, this is HM. Stop. Yes. No, this is not, okay, look. Look, so the force sits in the space HM, which is subspace on the space H. Yes, it equals to H, yes. Yes. No. This is an additional restriction. Right, wait. This is not the end of the story. Right, you're just absolutely right. There will be. I impose restrictions layer after layer. You're right. This will appear very soon. You will see. Now these are definitions, and now we start to construct our objects. Now look, as I said, I will examine solutions for my equation first on sigma 0, 1, next on sigma 0, 2, next on sigma from 1 to 2, next on 2 to 3. So the basic tool to do this is very natural. This is the shift mapping S. Mapping S is the following map. It takes our phase space H, the initial data sets, right? It takes space E. It takes space E, L2, where sits right hand side being considered from 0 to 1. And this map sends this back in the space H precisely, by the way, as in the case of Professor Grachev, so such that initial condition U0, and the my force restricted to the segment 0, 1, right? So this, or maybe let me do it like this. Right-hand side restricted to the segment 0, 1. Deterministic, so omega is fixed. Just I consider one equation with some one choice of the right-hand side, right? It has been sent to value of my solution at t equal 1. So just this is the map S, where of course u of t is a solution. Where u of t for 0 smaller than t smaller than 1 solves equation 1. Okay, so given initial data u0, value of my solution at time 1 equal to the map S applied to u0 and to restriction of my force to the first segment. U of 2 equals to the map S applied to u of 1, right? And with right-hand side, which is the restriction of my process to the segment number 2, etc. And just more general, we just recursively have that when we found our solution at time r, and this is S means I am going to use this object. Then to find solution at time and time r plus 1, I should apply map S at the value of solution at time r and to the right-hand side restricted to the segment number r, where r is integer, and just bigger than 0. Therefore, to study values of my solution at integer moments of time, I should simply iterate the map S, right? So to study long time behavior of solutions for equation 1, this is absolutely the same as to study multiple iterations of the map S. Of course, after this, when I do this, I will calculate solutions of my equation also only in integer values of time. Then I have to understand what happens in between. But this is easy. You can find discussion in the papers which I quoted. This is not a big deal, so I will not specify that. Okay, so this is map S. What is our restriction on what happens here? One restriction is just general, and I will not repeat it because it is absolutely innocent. This is assumption zero. The map S is C2 smooth. Why this assumption is innocent? Because if this is a nonlinear partial differential equation, and if you know that this equation is well posed such that for any solution L0 from H and from any right-hand side eta from the space E, I have only one solution, that always this map is smooth, always. This is just fact of life. This really goes together. When you start to learn nonlinear partial this equation, you will see that this always holds. We have technique how to do it. Again, it can be found in the papers. It is in these two or three papers which I referred to. Now I have to impose serious restrictions on the map S, and to impose them, I have to examine and to discuss one more object. So look, since the map S is C2 smooth. Since the map S is C2 smooth, here is S, I can consider differential of S, right? Which is a linear map at any point, linear map from H times E to eta. But I can also consider differential of eta of the map S evaluated at some point E prime eta prime, which is a map from just E to H, which of course eta prime belongs to H, U prime belongs to H, eta prime belongs to E, eta prime belongs to E, right? And this mapping, which will be important for me, this is, as I learned many years ago from Professor Agrachov, this mapping also very important from the theory of control and optimal control. Let us talk about this map. Okay. Let us examine how this map acts. Let us take any psi, which is element in the space E. This is just L2 curve, right? And let us ask ourselves how to construct d eta s of u prime eta prime applied to this psi. We know that this is an element of the space H, but how to construct this element? Let us denote it V. How to find out V? Well, for this end, let us repeat the construction of differential of the mapping S on the second variable eta. To do it, let us do the following. Let us consider eta epsilon, which equals to eta prime, this eta prime, plus epsilon times xi. Xi, this is this guy. Xi is this guy, right? This is a curve in the space E. Then simply by definition of the second differential, this guy V, the value of this differential, is defined like this. This is derivative in epsilon when epsilon equals to zero applied to S evaluated at u prime eta epsilon. Right? This is simply definition of the second differential. How to construct this object, how to put hand on it, how to understand which kind of person it is. Okay, let us consider this guy. To consider this guy, I have to consider equation star, which is the following equation: dt u epsilon plus L times U epsilon plus F of U epsilon of T equals to eta epsilon, this eta epsilon, right? And with the same initial data. U of zero equals to U prime. Then if U epsilon of T is a solution for this equation, then V, which I have here, this is simply d over d epsilon at epsilon equals to zero of u epsilon of one. This is V. This is V. Well, let us consider the whole curve. Let us consider value of this curve not at t equals to one, but the whole curve. Let us consider the curve u tilde of t equals to d over d epsilon at epsilon equals to zero to this my solution u epsilon of t. Let us consider this curve. Let us find out equation for this curve, but this is easy. Let us simply differentiate the relation star in epsilon and to calculate this derivative when epsilon equals to zero. Then look, let us do this. When I differentiate in epsilon the first term, I have dt u epsilon tilde, right? Because derivative in epsilon at this guy at epsilon equals to zero equals to u tilde. U tilde plus f of L tilde plus, and now a bit more complicated. I have to differentiate in epsilon at epsilon equals to zero this object. But okay, it is also basic analysis. This is differential of f evaluated at u of t, because when epsilon equals to zero, u zero equals to u, apply to u tilde. And this equals to eta epsilon, differentiated in epsilon. But this is just xi. This is just xi, right? Initial condition doesn't depend on epsilon. So u tilde of zero, u zero equals to zero, right? So we see that this mapping which we have here, this is the following one. This is the following one. Well, just maybe write it right here. So d eta calculated at some pair u prime eta prime sends element xi of the space E, which is L2 curve, to u tilde of one, where u tilde is a function which solves equation two star. Right? Okay. So now we are very close to the same panorama of what happens here. So look, so this is my equation. This is time one map along trajectories for this equation. Of course, time one map in this setting depends on the right hand side restricted to the corresponding segment. I took out of blue, but we will see very soon why it is needed, that linearization of this time map on the second variable is very important. Please note that this is rather complicated map, because it's a linear map, okay. This linear map sends one Hilbert space to another. But these two Hilbert spaces, they are very different, because this is a Hilbert space roughly formed by function of t. Because if M is finite, for example, if M capital is one, this is simply L2 space of function of T. But this is space of function of X, right? So this is clever mapping. Clever mapping which transforms function of T to the function of space variable. It cannot be easy. It is not easy. This mapping is responsible for big part of difficulties which we have in the theory of optimal control. Okay, but now I am approaching. So now I will impose condition which guarantee mixing, and we will also see what does it mean mixing. So if you have questions, just let us ask the question now. So just to be sure that you understand as much as possible what we are talking about. So no. Okay, so look, now comes sin. I impose two sets of restrictions to my equation one. These two sets of restrictions, they are weaker group of restrictions and they are stronger group of restrictions. So to the left will be weaker group of restriction. To the right will be stronger group of restriction. There will be altogether four of them. Weaker group of restrictions. And here will be stronger group of restrictions. Why I put two? Because more interesting is result concerning weaker group of restrictions. I will discuss the proof for the case of a stronger group of restrictions. But then I will show that it's rather easy to explain what has to be added to couple with this to handle with this more complicated problem when we have weaker group of restrictions. Okay. So first condition is regularity. B1 without prime, name of this condition is regularity. Regularity. And here there is B1 prime. Okay. there is beginning is the same for both strong and weak. There is a Banach space, or Hilbert space, maybe Hilbert. There is a Hilbert space. It may be Banach, but it doesn't matter. Hilbert space V, which is embedded in my phase space H, with compact and dense, and this embedding is compact and dense. Compact and dense. Compact and dense. And dense. What I'm talking about. You remember that for the case of complex Ginzburg-Landau, HM is a space, my H is a space, is a subspace HM, right? When we apply this theorem to complex Ginzburg-Landau, then V will be space H, HM plus one. This is typical, this is a bit smoother, set of a bit smoother functions. Then the embedding of HM plus one to HM is compact and dense. And now weaker, now stronger restriction. Then the map S, H times E to V is C2 smooth. I said this already, but you see, but it's more. There is a smoothing property. Before I said that it is C2 smooth like this, but it is smoother. But if we talk about nonlinear parabolic equation, it is always the same. And here I assume that the map S, H times E to V is analytic. It is a bit contradictory, not a bit contradictory, because I have written this at weaker restriction, but of course this assumption is stronger. But weak is the whole group. In fact, for all practical purposes, always this is fulfilled and this is fulfilled. So practically no difference. Because if you are speaking about functional spaces, if some realistical map, which is obtained by some realistic manipulation, if it is C1 smooth, it will be analytic. It's a fact of life. Condition B2 is the same. It is independent. There are no strong form and weak form. Name for condition B2 is dissipativity. Dissipativity. Dissipativity, it is rather nice. It is like this. That firstly, let me remind you that I denoted support of the measure L of the measure L chi, right? This is a compact in the space E, and the restriction is that zero belongs to this compact. What does it mean? That I can switch off the random force. Very, very, very important condition. You see, because since zero belongs to support of my measure, then with positive probability, it happens that the right-hand side is as small as I wish. It means that I can switch off random force. It is technically, it is very important, right? And apart from this, I assume that there exists gamma smaller than one. There is some non-negative beta, such that two properties holds. First follows from the second, but I prefer to keep it like this. Norm of S U of eta is bounded gamma times U plus beta. You see, contraction, which comes from the dissipation, plus something else, looks very restrictive, but it always holds for well-posed nonlinear parabolic equation. It holds for two-dimensional Navier-Stokes. If you can prove that three-dimensional Navier-Stokes is well-posed, I'm practically sure this also will be true, right? Yes? For CGL almost, with one difference, because I have shown you energy estimate for L2 norm, but this must be HM, but you're right. This is a technical difference. Right. So energy balance essentially is estimate. And B, this is, watch. B that if I switch off the force, right, then my solution decay. Gamma is right? So if I consider this equation, then because of dissipation, all my solutions will just exponentially quickly converge, converge to zero, right? So this is B2. This is B2. The whole point is the condition B3. So this is innocent. This is just innocent, believe me. This always is true if you are talking about nonlinear parabolic equation. Massimiliano asked me what happens if it is nonlinear hyperbolic equation. This is violated. This is violated and also this smoothing. Smoothing, you see, twice. So I use dissipation twice. But now comes B3. B3 is the whole point. B3 is the whole point. This is called non-degeneracy. It's called non-degeneracy. 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 Which is, and B3 prime, it is also non-degeneracy. But now non-degeneracy in stronger form, and here non-degeneracy in weaker form. Look, non-degeneracy in stronger form. For any U, for any eta, from support of measure L, if I consider the mapping, this d eta, the linearized mapping, the linearized mapping, right? Then the image of this linearized mapping, the total image, right, is dense in the space H. Is dense in the space H. Is dense in the space H. Is dense in the space H, right? This is delicate. This is really optimal control. This is precisely what optimal control working with. You see, there is a subtle point here, subtle point, because you see, map S. In fact, image of the map S belongs to smoother space V. Here I require density only in weaker space H, right? Why? Because if I replace here H by V, this is usually wrong. This is the density which we can really prove for a realistical equation, right? So with this equation, I can prove mixing relatively easy. Easier. The problem with this condition is that probably this equation holds, usually holds, if m equals to infinity, but not if m is finite. Not if m is finite, you see? This condition is nice. This is right, absolutely yes, absolutely precisely. This is a linearized controllability, and which is a tool to study approximated controllability. Yes. The eta of SU eta of E is dense. Right? So second condition is more sophisticated, but it holds very often. It holds for huge class of forces like this with finite m. For example, for two-dimensional Navier-Stokes, we can take m equals 3. For complex Ginzburg-Landau, we can take m equal to 5. And the condition which I will write down here is fulfilled. So look. For any eta of H, for any initial data, right? There exists subset of good forces, which is big of full measure, right? Subset of forces of good measure, such that for any U and for any force from this KU, the image is dense. D, the linearized mapping, S of U eta, its total image is dense in H, right? This condition looks not that natural, but this is what we have in real life. And this is precisely what quite a number of years ago, maybe 10, Professor Agrachov explained us how to do this. First, it took for me some efforts just to convince him that this is a good question, which was worth of efforts just to find how to prove it, but then he did it. Okay, let me make it more compact because I need space. For any U, for any eta, eta belongs in KU. KU range of d eta of SU is dense. is dense. Now comes the last assumption. This is regularity of the components of the force. This is regularity of the force. It is the same. It is before. It is the same. It doesn't exist in weaker and stronger forms. So I write it without separation. Name for this condition is decomposibility. Decomposibility. Terrible. Decomposibility. Decomposibility of eta 1 and non-degeneracy. And non-degeneracy. Okay. So look, let us consider the process eta 1, this one. Let us consider restriction of this process of the segment J1. Because we remember that restriction on the segment J2, this is the same process, but independent copy. Let's give to this guy name eta 1,1, which is natural, right? So low index, this is Fourier component. Upper index, this is which segment in time. So eta 1,1, this is a random process. This is just a random process which takes value in the real line. Then this process eta 1,1, for every omega, it belongs to the space L2, 0, 1. Then assumption is there exists a basis in the space L2, 0, 1, and we call this basis E1, E2, etc., such that the process eta 1,1 is simply random series with respect to this basis. Random series with respect to this basis. So look, what does it mean? It means that eta 1,1 of omega of t, this is summation from 1 to infinity, total decomposition of the basis Ej, and now quite similar. Here comes Bj tilde, which measures how big is the coefficient of the composition number j, and here comes Xij omega. And here comes Xij omega. Here I assume that all Bj tilde are non-zero, so we have real non-degeneracy. And here I assume that again this Xij's, Xi1, Xi2, etc., are again independent, identically distributed random variables from omega to real line, right? Such that, oops, not good. Such that I will move here. Such that the law of every random variable Xij, it has a density with respect to the Lebesgue measure. And this density is supported by segment minus 1,1, supported by the segment minus 1,1, right? It means that these random variables Xij, they are bigger than minus 1 and smaller than 1. They are bounded by 1 in modulus. Rho of R is a Lipschitz function, right? And also rho of zero is positive. So these are our restrictions. This again, after this, now with these restrictions, of course, you see, so we have to check consistency of these sets of our restrictions. We have to check that this set of restrictions is consistent. which restrictions on equations. As I said, that quite a lot of nonlinear partial differential equations fit satisfy restrictions B1, B2, B2, B3. What about restriction before? Restriction before, it is always fulfilled if you take some non-trivial basis in non-trivial basis EJ in the space of function, namely if you take Haar basis. Excuse me? No, that's absolutely different. EJ is a function of T, of time. So this is a bit tricky. So my functions are, you see, watch the following. Let us consider space of function u of tx. This is what we really keep in mind, right? Let us consider L2 on 0, 1 times td. Let us consider space of my solution when time is from 0, 1 and x is z. What is the basis in this space? The basis in this space precisely is formed by all pairs of function ej of t phi j of x, phi l of x. Right? These products, when 1 smaller than j, l smaller than infinity, gives me basis in the space of function of tx. I need both. I need two bases to construct a base in the space of functions of the base of functions of two variables, right? So these are the conditions. They will be imposed always. So now inverts, if this condition holds, then the equation one is mixing. But then first I want to develop language of Markov chains just to define properly. Let me state this theorem right now, and just to show you that this is something really important. I will state a theorem, maybe in not completely rigorous way right now, and then I will develop rigorous language and I state the theorem properly. Then theorem. So yes, it's absolutely rigorous statement. It's correct. If either strong condition holds, B1 before, or weak condition holds, or B1 prime before prime holds, right? If this condition holds, then there exists one and only one. There exists a unique measure, mu star, in the space of measures in H, right? Such that for any initial data U0 in the space H, for any initial data 0 in the space H, if I do the following. Now let us consider this solution U of T satisfy. This solution U of T satisfies. Okay, I take my solution U of T. It's a random variable, right? Since it's a random variable, it has a law. Law of random variable is a measure in the space H, right? I have this very special measure in the space mu star, and this measure converges to this measure weakly in the space of measures. Precisely, it means the following. It is the same as to say, if I take bounded continuous functional, if I take any f, which is bounded continuous functional in H, right? Then if I take f of u omega of t, if I take expected value of f of the omega of t, that this converges to the integral of function f against the measure mu star, right? And I stress that it holds for every initial data u zero. Another extremely important point here is that the convergence is exponentially quick. Is exponentially fast, right? This is what physicists know very well. Just one example. One example is that in physical community, they believe that is, essentially they just agree, so practically everybody, that right language to describe water turbulence is the following. We take 3D Navier-Stokes equation, and they believe that it's well posed, right? We force this equation by random force. They would be happy with this random force, right? And then they believe that this system is mixing, that this property holds. And then when you open, and if you take this pile of book on the theory of turbulence, a little pile like this, or maybe 10 times like this, right? That all these books are about this measure. So all these books are only about, they call it limiting statistical equilibrium, right? But this is really great, right? So you see, our system forget initial data. Our system, if you talk about statistical properties of solution, then from this point of view, our system forgets initial data, right? So this is mixing. This is the mixing, right? And you see, I am really sure that these conditions, they're very close to necessary also. So you cannot seriously violate one of these conditions and think that I think that if you violate them more or less seriously, then the result may be wrong. Right? And I repeat that the condition B3, this is essentially condition in terms of optimal control. This is why the school is joined these two lecture courses. But there are three ingredients in proof of this theorem: optimal control, how this condition plays, technique of Markov processes, which I will explain right now, and the component number three, this is the method of quadratic convergence. The method of quadratic convergence, this is also often called as KEM theory, and this I will clearly explain you. Because KEM theory, if you understand, for example, it's in the version of Kolmogorov, it is extremely hard to explain it on the lecture, but here everything happens in such a form that it is very possible. So my lectures will be about this. Now I have to explain who are here Markov processes. I will develop the language of Markov processes, and I will explain you Döblin approach to prove mixing. Because I did not know if you really have saw this, but in his lecture, Andrei Grachev explained how to prove mixing in finite dimensional evoking tools of optimal control. My proof is different. I will tell you about different proof of this result, which originated on the approach of Döblin. Döblin. If you do not know this name, I suggest to look to Wikipedia, because it's a person of remarkable and tragical life and absolutely brilliant mathematician. It was really remarkable French expert in probability, Paul Lévy. I think he was the only student of Paul Lévy. Maybe Lévy has two or three, no, but no more. Just look in Wikipedia, you will see why. Okay, so now I will start. It is not that a big deal. I don't know, maybe just what is left from this lecture is not enough. I am starting to tell you about Markov processes and just Markov chain. You see, strangely enough, if you take, yes. No. It's another story. No. This is tons of books on probability are about. Okay, this object exists, no doubt. They even do not talk. But then they start to the how energy is distributed. And they write one volume, another 10, 50 volumes. You see? So this theorem gives you an object, and then you start to study the object, and then you start to write books. Since no proofs are there, so you can write 50, 100, 200 books. Okay, so now Okay, okay. So now you see. So now we are talking. Now look. So where is this S? I have erased S, which is not a good idea. Okay. So anyhow. So we have this. We have the system S, which is iteration, which are made by iterations of the map S. So system S is obtained by the following rule. To calculate U of K, I have to apply the map S to U of K minus 1 and to eta K. Eta K, this is the force restricted to the segment number K. And this is for K bigger or equal than 1. And then U0 is given. You see, now who is this U0 who is given? This U0 is who? It is very important. Very important that this given initial data, U0 in H, is either a constant, or is a random variable in the space H, independent from the forces. independent from eta 1, eta 2, etc. Okay? And this is how it should be. This is how it must be. This is the law. If you try to consider initial data which are not independent from the forces, we arrive at absolutely different problems. This is jungles. But this setting is good, and we can slowly move forward in this setting. Right. Now first trivial observation, which is very important to what follows. You see, let us consider the law of the random variable UK. Look, this is the law of S applied to UK minus one, which is a random object, and to random force eta. Okay, but now let me. I have to start with something different. So look at this relation. From this relation, we see that UK is a function of what? Is a function of initial data, of the force eta 1, up to the force eta k, right? Function, some complicated function. This is why it's a big job to study this. But it's a function of U0, eta 1, eta k. But so it is independent. It is independent from eta k plus 1, eta k plus 2, eta k plus 2, etc. Right? You see? So this is where from Markovness very soon will come. Now it's precisely like this, eta k, right? Eta k. But now look, it means that this is the law. It means that this is a push forward under the mapping S of the law of the pair of the pair UK minus one omega eta k. Eta k, right? From what is written here, the random variable UK minus one is independent from the random variable eta k. But this is one of things which everybody should remember. Since the random variable eta k minus one is independent from the random variable eta k, then the law of the pair of this random variable is the direct product of the two measures. This measure is the direct product of the two measures. But the measure number ek, I gave a name to this measure. This is the measure L. right? So this is what I said. So this is in the theory of probability, this is their common wisdom. So theory of probability, so functional analysis ends, and the theory of probability starts when we start to talk about independent random variable. You see, so this is the vector in the space H, oh, excuse me, U, okay. This is a pair which belongs in the space H times E, right? So this is a measure in the direct product of two spaces. Because of independence, it is a product of measure here times measure here. This is construction how to arrange direct product of measure. This is general and just rather easy. Now let us go here. So this is a mapping S. This is a mapping S applied to the law, of my solution when time k minus one times measure L. Look, this is explicit formula. It is explicit formula, but it is not easy explicit. It is not easy profit from it because it is extremely complicated. Because, okay, this is, we iteratively construct, we can iteratively find distributions of the random variable eta 1, eta 2, eta 3, et cetera, iteratively using this formula. Therefore, the sequence of the measures, which is the law of the solution at time equal one, the law of the solution at time equal two, this is a sequence of the measures in the space H, right? Depends only on initial data u zero, depends only on the measure L, right? And depends on the mapping S. What is very important here? We have seen something very important. If the system S is defined like this, and if we assumed by assumption that eta 1, eta 2, eta 3, they independent, identically distributed random variables in the space of curves E, right? Then in fact, our solution, the distribution of our solutions in integer values of time, they do not depend on specific choice of these random forces, but only on their law. This is very convenient because at some stages of our construction, it will be convenient for me to tell, let us now consider a bit different forces eta k, still that they're independent, identically distributed, and their laws are L. So for example, okay, right. You see, so this formula which we have here for every physicist, so what is written here? That the law of solution at time k plus one depends only on the law of solution. Excuse me. The law of solution, what is written here? The law of solution at time k depends only on the law of solution at time k minus one and on the law of the force which we use to stir our system, right? For every physicist, it means that what we have here, uk omega when k equals to 0, 1, 2, etc., is a Markov process with discrete time. The name of Markov process with discrete time is the Markov chain. So physically, this precisely means that UK is a Markov chain. Unfortunately, if you take any textbook of Markov chains or Markov processes, you will find there much more complicated definition. much more complicated definition because this is a very special, this is an easy case of Markov chains, Markov processes. So what I will do next time, I will introduce what is needed from the theory of Markov chains and Markov processes just to follow what follows. Because really indeed, so this situation, and this is not, by the way, because this book on Markov systems, they are bad. No, they are good. Simply they are written to treat general case. So general case is really much more complicated. But this is very easy, very nice, and very clean case of Markov processes. We will discuss them next time, but now I will do something just to finish our lecture. I will do something simple. I will do the following. So you see, as I explained, we are free to replace this sequence of random forces to sequence of random forces which we like. So then there is one choice of random forces which I like the best. This is, let me call this a canonical model. So canonical model, now I will show you how to define this sequence of independent, identically distributed process, these forces eta k, which are really more convenient, which is the most convenient to work with. Easy. Look, we have our probability space omega fp. Let us take independent copies of this probability space. Take independent copies of omega. That is, consider probability space omega 1, omega 2, omega 3, which are simply independent copies. Omega 1 with sigma algebra F1 probability P, omega 2 with F2 P2, but they are the same, right? The same. And let us do the following. Let us assume that our force eta k, which I have here, it is eta k, which depends on the variable omega k from the random space omega k. Then clearly they are independent, right? Because they are defined on different probability spaces. And let us choose that this is, so to say, a copy of the same random variable. So eta k is independent copy, that's what I said. Independent eta k, omega k to a, independent copy of eta 1. This sounds trivial, but this model helps a lot to make everything cleaner, more elementary and easier. Just one remark, so to say, you may say that formally this canonical model does not fit to what I told you, because I told you that we have probability space omega, we have random variable defined on omega. But now, instead of this, I suggest you countably many probability spaces, and my random variable is defined in this way, right? A solution is very easy. Let us consider real probability space, omega nu, which is direct product of all this. Omega 1, omega 2, blah, 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 right? And with sigma algebras, which are direct product, blah, 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 right? Then simply this force number k depends only on the component k of this bigger probability space, right? This will be very convenient to write explicitly the constructions which I want to write, but I think I will finish here, because next topic is called preliminaries on Markov chains, and after this preliminaries I will state the theorem in a way which is the most suitable, and I will explain how to prove it. Okay. So this is the end of the story for today.